everybody. I'm Lauren Shadford. Good morning. And yes, great for being scrappy this morning and everybody getting out. I think cabin fever set in for quite a few of us this weekend. I'm really pleased to be moderating this panel today, this Chubb panel on art and authenticity. And I'm extremely pleased to have three distinguished colleagues joining us today to talk about their perspectives on this issue. Joe Laird will be speaking about the authentication process connected with the legal world. Christopher Gaillard will be speaking about certificates of authenticity within the scope of the appraisal process. And Julia Halperin will be speaking about the status of authentication today, including new authentication methods, as well as where contemporary artists are falling in these issues. I'll introduce everybody first. They'll each be speaking for about 10 minutes, and then we're hoping to have a nice chunk of time at the end to have some questions. So I hope everyone will save your questions for the end when we can get into a little bit of a dialogue about these issues. To start off, Joe Backer Laird is of counsel at Patterson Belknap. Ms. Laird brings over 25 years of experience to Patterson Belknap, where she concentrates her practice on all aspects of art law, working with artists, private collectors, museums, arts organizations, galleries, dealers, advisors, and financial institutions. Quite a bit of experience. Prior to her time there, she was the Senior Vice President and General Counsel of Christie's for 10 years, where she was responsible for all legal issues related to the company's business in North and South America. She has extensive knowledge and experience in the full range of transactions and litigation issues related to works of art and the art market. She's also an adjunct professor of art law at the Columbia University School of Art.
School of Law.
Art. she received her JD from there and received her MPA from the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton University and her AB from Princeton as well. She will be followed by Christopher Gaillard, who's the Deputy Chairman, Chief Advisor, and Appraiser of Contemporary Art at Gurr Johns. Christopher has provided appraisals for tax estate, charitable donations, insurance purposes, and advises private clients on acquiring and deaccessioning works of art. Before he joined Gurr Johns, he was the Vice President and Director of Contemporary Prints at Sotheby's and the Vice President of the Prints Department at Christie's. And he's been a member of the International Print Center of New York since 2002. Followed by Christopher, Julia Halperin will be speaking. She is the Deputy Museums Editor for the Art Newspaper, where she commissions and edits all of its coverage related to museums and art institutions internationally. She was previously the news editor at Art and Auction Magazine and artinfo.com, and her writing has appeared in the New York Observer, Modern Painters, and New York Magazine. So we have quite a few wonderful people to speak. I'm gonna pass it off to Joe, who's gonna start, and then I will see you back for questions afterwards.
John, can you hear me? When you talk about that I'm going to be speaking about this in sort of the connection with the law, the fact that what I'm going to really be talking about is the disconnect between issues of authenticity and the law, and let me explain what I mean. When you are talking about art, obviously the value of art is affected enormously by the issue of authenticity. That is the central fact, both in terms of art historical value and financial value. When you are talking about authenticity, a certificate of authenticity or inclusion in a catalog resume is really the gold standard. But it's a gold standard in the same way as you remember the old saying about in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. It's that kind of gold standard. It is a flawed gold standard in a flawed and complicated set of circumstances, a market, and set of conditions. It's flawed for a number of reasons. First of all, just in terms of substance, a certificate of authenticity is only as valuable as the person who has given it. Who's the expert who's given it to you? Is it an expert that the market recognizes? How does a market come to recognize an expert? It's sort of an organic process. There's no regimented or procedural basis on which somebody gets to be the grand authenticator. Now that we'll talk about how there are fewer in the business now. Of straight authentication, there is somebody, and I forget his name, who is now selling authentication services. Whether or not those authentications will be accepted in the market, I'm skeptical. But who is it who's given? Also, that person, whoever it is, and let's assume that it is an expert who is recognized by the market, that person may change their mind. And if they change their mind, the certificate of authenticity that you have that is signed by that person becomes worthless. That person may be superseded. The market may lose confidence in that expert, or the expert may die. And somebody becomes the newly appointed market expert. And that newly appointed market expert may have different opinions. Or there may be a period of uncertainty, at which point the value of your certificate of authenticity also goes down. If you're talking about a primary market, something that has happened, a certificate of authenticity that has in fact been issued by an artist. Under various moral rights statutes, there are circumstances in which an artist can simply disclaim a work. And so there is inherent, at which point, again, your certificate of authenticity is essentially worthless. And so what you've got is as good as it might be able to get, but it isn't foolproof. There is always some risk. Lawyers like to think that where there is risk or where there is something that might go on, there must be some procedure for correcting it. And this is where we get to the disconnect between authenticity issues and the law. The fact is, there's really nothing legal that you can do about it. I mean, absolutely nothing. We get requests all the time from people saying, I can't get this authentication board or this expert to authenticate my work. I want to sue them. The fact is that the courts have been very clear that those lawsuits aren't going to work. The courts in this district have said that nobody, even the recognized market expert, has any obligation to give you an opinion at all. Nor will the court second guess any opinion that you have received. With one exception. And that is that if there is a dispute, an individual dispute, a concrete dispute between a seller and a buyer, as an example, where the seller says, yes, what I sent you is authentic, and the buyer says, no, it's fake. The court, as they did in a case involving a Calder some years ago, will resolve that dispute because that's what courts do. And in that case, the court looked at essentially had a contest of experts, looked at the facts that were presented, had different experts come in. Klaus Perls, who was the recognized Calder expert, said that he thought it was a fake, but the court nevertheless decided that on a preponderance of the evidence, more likely than not, 51%, and remember, because we'll come back to that standard of proof later, that it was authentic. That's great. That thing is still sitting in the warehouse of the gallery that owned it, because nobody in the market is accepting a federal district court as an expert on authenticity. So as regards that dispute between the parties, the people who had purchased and thought it was fake were stuck with it, but they haven't been able to sell it for years. So you can't, essentially what it means is, I mean, the courts really become quite frustrated with the idea, quite frustrated with the art market. One judge in another case involving a Calder said, look, it's not our job. We don't have the expertise to authenticate something. And we understand that these people who can authenticate have a disproportionate kind of power in the market. That, says the judge, not my problem. If that's the way the art market organizes itself, that's fine. I can't do anything about that. So what happens is that there is this deference to art authenticators, in essence because the right analogy is to scholarship. You can't imagine, or maybe one could these days, suing a scholar for not having published some kind of a thesis. You can't imagine suing a scholar for saying, my scholarly opinion is that Rembrandt painted this picture. And the authenticators really are analogous to scholars, or that's the way the courts look at it. And so what happens is that in these litigations, the authenticators always win, which is why if you've got some beef against an authenticator, it is useless to sue them unless you can prove that they have done something that is otherwise unlawful. They've engaged in an antitrust kind of conspiracy, which was the claim against the Warhol Authentication Committee. They have engaged in fraud. Very difficult to show. But in terms of just their opinion, or giving you an opinion, or giving you the opinion that that you want them to give you, it's not going to work. It's really not going to work. And so one would think that authenticators were in great shape. Problem is, this is America, and people sue anyway. I mean, it's a spectator sport. There's a problem, let's go to court. And that's what happened with the Warhol Foundation. This happened any number of times before with authenticators who are considerably less wealthy than the Warhol Foundation. But even with its wealth, when the foundation spent over $11 million in legal fees to defeat Joe Simon Whalen's antitrust claim, they said, you know what? We're out of here. We're not doing authentications anymore. It is not worth it to us. They said they would continue to do catalogs resume. They would continue the work on the Andy Warhol catalogs resume, which at the time I kind of flippantly said, well, that's nice, they're not going to authenticate things, but they are going to continue to tell us what is authentic. But thinking about it more, I think, you know, what it really is distancing themselves from the market. That when somebody comes to you for a certificate of authenticity for something that they own and are planning and selling, that connects it to the market, which makes it somewhat less of a purely scholarly venture. And I think that by continuing the catalog's resume, but not responding to current requests for authentication, that really does, even just cosmetically or psychically, separate them out and make it more of a work of scholarship. Other authentication committees followed suit. Basquiat, I could list them off, but I'm having a senior moment. But fewer and fewer authenticators and foundations are now in the business of authenticating works on a current basis. And catalogs resume take a long time to come out, so that leaves the market in a kind of limbo. If you've got a Warhol and it has not yet been included in a catalog, what do you do? If you're trying to consign something to an auction house and they say, look, we just don't sell them unless so-and-so and so-and-so gives us a positive opinion, and they're not giving opinions anymore, what do you do? So the Bar Association of the City of New York, the Art Law Committee, of which I was a member at the time, decided we're going to try to do something about this and to essentially level the playing field. That it wasn't the law that was crushing authenticators. As a matter of law, they always won, but it was the legal system. It was the threat of litigation, the threat of the cost of getting from here to there. So we proposed legislation, and the legislation would do a number of things. First of all, it would raise the standard of proof that a plaintiff would have to, the standard of specificity with which a plaintiff would have to allege some kind of wrongdoing. So it's not just, oh, I think they're doing this because they have other they have other Warhols that they want to increase the value of those Warhols. No, you have to say, he said this, they did this. The kind of specificity that you have to allege for any lawyers in the room when you are alleging fraud. They also had to meet, plaintiffs had to meet, something called a standard of clear and convincing evidence, which is a higher standard than a preponderance of the evidence. It's somewhere in between the 51% and beyond a reasonable doubt that you have to meet for criminal cases. So they had to reach the higher standard. And I thought most importantly, if an authenticator won the lawsuit, that the authenticator, but never the plaintiff, would be entitled to receive their legal fees. In other words, hey guys, yeah, if you want to sue me, that's fine, but understand, you've really got to have something. Because if you don't, I'm going to win, and you're going to wind up paying my legal fees. And that was meant to be, that was meant to be able to give authenticators more comfort providing the sort of central function to the market that they provide. It has, that statute has now passed the New York State Senate, but has not yet passed the Assembly, but it's been watered down. And it's been watered down, frankly, because we hit the lawyers. Forgive me. But the lawyers in the legislature took a look, and to some extent, even some lawyers on the committee took a look and said, well, why should authenticators be given this protection and other professionals not be given this kind of protection? They missed the analogy. Authenticators are not analogous to lawyers or accountants or whoever. They're analogous to scholars. That's different. Scholars get to be negligent, lawyers don't. And or let me put it a different way. Scholars get to be negligent and risk their reputation. I'm negligent, you get to sue me. Different. And the way it got watered down was that the standard of proof has been taken away, which is important, that the standard of proof remains a preponderance of the evidence as opposed to clear and convincing evidence. And while authenticators who are successful may be awarded legal fees, there is no guarantee that they will be awarded legal fees. So in terms of deflecting or preventing baseless lawsuits, it's not the same. The two-minute warning. I watched two of those yesterday. In addition to the transition in that sense, and you'll be hearing about this a little bit more today, we're also in a bizarre situation now where, because of different, you know, developments in technology, as well as developments in different sorts of forms of art, the whole concept of a certificate of authenticity is getting stretched. And I know we're talking about the idea of, you know, conceptual art, where a certificate of authenticity actually, in effect, becomes the artwork. That if you, and that opens new legal issues for certificates of authenticity. If you have a conceptual piece of art, what you will often get is a certificate that says, this is how you create this, and you have a right to create it, and you have a right to create it X number of times. If you lose that certificate, you will not likely be able to get a replacement from the artist or from the foundation or whatever, because the same way you wouldn't be able to say, I lost my painting. Could you repaint a picture for me? So that creates, you know, there's an awful lot of theoretical stuff going on. All of this is art, not science. And so we're in a huge period of transition.
So as you can see, it's a very complex issue. So my role as deputy chairman at Gurr Johns is to do appraisals and also art advisory, where we buy and sell for clients. Often the two are dovetailed. We appraise something and then we are asked to broker the sale. And I, as the appraiser, approach objects, in my case, contemporary art, some 19th century, some early 20th century, but mostly contemporary art. I approach it the same way. What am I looking at? Who is the artist? What are the materials it is made of? How is it signed? What's on the back of the painting? Are there gallery labels? And also, what is the provenance? How did it come to be owned by the person that owns it now? And on and on and on. And I have a sort of a rolling list of questions that I go through and stand in front of works of art. And in a way, a work of art comes to me and says either I'm right or I'm wrong. You sort of feel it if you've been doing it long enough, as I've been doing it, and I see there are a number of friendly faces and appraisers in the audience. You sort of know there's something about a work of art that either feels right or it doesn't. But then again, that's just a gut reaction, and it has to be proven that it is actually, to me, it is correct, and it is right, and it is authentic. We are presented a lot of times with works of art that have an accompanying certificate of authenticity. As Joe points out, there is a lot of dispute about who gave you that certificate of authenticity. Are they still around? Who believes their word out in the marketplace today? An overarching thing we have to remember in the art world and in the world in general is that scholarship is always changing. So that certificate may be good today, but it may not be good tomorrow in terms of its saleability. In terms of appraisals, I'll talk about two different types of appraisals that we focus on. Primarily, one is retail replacement value, which is for an insurance purpose, where you would give it to your broker or your underwriter, and your painting would be insured for the full amount. And it is generally seen as the highest value out in the marketplace. It's a value that if you, in a compressed amount of time, needed to replace a painting, it's really, you'd have to most likely go to a gallery, which is probably the highest value out there at the moment versus an auction value, which would generally be considered a fair market value, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. For retail replacement value, when we are asked to value objects for that particular value, yes, of course, I go through my list of questions, one of them being, is there a certificate of authenticity if it applies to that particular artist and that particular object? Is it considered valid today? But also, we are in a good position as appraisers, is we're not authenticators. We come to things and we either believe that they are or they are not based on our experience, on our research, and asking these numbers of questions. We can make assumptions and put those in our report, saying we assume this work of art is authentic. And that is a customary practice. It's absolutely one that the IRS and all the appraisers agree is a necessary thing to do to get a credible result, which is the value of the object. We could spend the rest of our lives wondering and trying to figure out if something is authentic or not, but simply because we're usually under a time constraint, we just have to make that assumption that it is right or it is not right and apply the value accordingly. Differently, in fair market value, which usually has some kind of financial or tax implication that is imminent, in the case of a donation where someone might be getting some kind of tax benefit, the donor would be getting a tax benefit, or in an estate tax when there is tax owed to the federal government, we have to be a bit more stringent about that. And Joe brings up a very interesting point about, and I think she's referencing Saul LeWitt, whose certificates are actually the work of art themselves. And I don't know if any of you have seen, there's a fantastic show right now at Mass MoCA where the wall drawings of Saul LeWitt are on view, probably I think for the next 10 years, and you should all see it. But the item of value in those cases is a piece of paper where he has written his instructions and signed it and given the person that owns that piece of paper the right to have that work installed on walls. And as majestic as they are and as dazzling as they are, the object of value in that particular case is the piece of paper on which those instructions and the signature are written. We have clients where we have valued wall drawings, but we've never seen a certificate, and we have applied value to that with the understanding and the assumption that that certificate actually exists. Usually it's in a vault or it is framed and is kept very carefully in a warehouse somewhere. And so for a retail replacement value, we might not need to see that certificate, and we can apply the value accordingly. For fair market value, we would absolutely need to see that to make sure that it does exist, because there is this financial component attached to it. Someone's going to have to pay tax on it, or they're going to get a tax break. Each individual artist and each individual value we're applying to something varies. It's almost like you're opening up a new book every time you look at a painting and are having to value it. You have to understand how certificates weigh in. And often we are, and this is more often than not, certificates of authenticity are not available. They're simply not available for certain artists. I was involved in a case where I was asked to value a group of works on paper by Willem de Kooning. And the Willem de Kooning Foundation does not authenticate. There is currently no catalogue raisonné in production. So we were kind of on our own deciding whether or not these objects were by the hand of the artist or not. And I looked at them, and I thought, the palette is wrong. It does not conform to what I know. The signatures also don't conform to what I know of Willem de Kooning's signatures. And collectively, amongst the appraisers at Gurr Johns, and with some of our appraisal consultants, and with other people out in the marketplace, we did do a little bit of reconnaissance of what people thought, and collectively we all came up with the idea that they were not by the artist. They were gifts to the present owner, and with gifts you would imagine he would have written a dedication. There were no dedications, and on and on. It makes, of course, me very uncomfortable to say something is not by the hand of an artist when all along for many years it has been purported to be by that artist. But unfortunately, that's the case of what we do daily. I said I break hearts every day of the week is what I like to say. But it puts us, every single case is different. And in terms of Warhol, as Joe also points out, we have clients who, in one case, a client came to me with a wonderful painting of flowers, which is, more and more a very desirable object. And this is one that the support is right, the canvas is absolutely right, the stretcher is spot on, signature is absolutely his signature, but unfortunately it only came to light in his father's estate recently. So this is after the Warhol Authentication Board disbanded. And he said, well, I'd like to sell it. And I said, well, unfortunately, you are, as Joe says very aptly, it's in limbo. You could sell it, perhaps, and be on the hook that it is actually not by the hand of the artist when the catalogue raisonné is completed, and that is who knows how many years away. So it does kind of put us in a funny position of how do we value that kind of an object. If it doesn't have a certificate, it's not yet in the catalogue raisonné, but it says to me as the appraiser that it's absolutely right. And what we have done in the past, and it depends on the purpose, and each purpose is different, each object is different, and every scope of work is different, we might give two values. We might say, if everything checks out and this is an absolutely by the hand of Andy Warhol, the value is X, and if it goes before the board, it is not included in the catalogue raisonné when it is completed, it is Y. At the heart of it, appraisals are meant to be guidelines for our clients and to help them make decisions. So by giving two values on something, we're sort of hedging our bets, but we're at least giving them some kind of help where if, depending upon a decision down the road. And on and on. And I'm sure there will be other questions about this and various artists going forward. Julia?
So I'm going to talk a bit about the latest news in the field of authentication and also how contemporary artists are, or as the case may be, are not thinking about certificates when they create new work. And so, as we've spoken about a bit already, there is this kind of this tension between sort of old school connoisseurship and scholarship, which is becoming increasingly difficult to give in opinions publicly. And forensic science, which is kind of an emerging area that is stepping in an attempt to fill the breach left by scholars that are afraid to give opinions. And it's something that is still, I think, in very early stages and hasn't necessarily been widely accepted as an alternative. But there are some interesting developments going on there, one of which is the Global Center for Innovation at SUNY Albany, which is a kind of think tank at SUNY that is working to develop synthetic DNA that artists could insert into their work and then could be using a scanner. You could get access to a sort of encrypted database that would tell you, okay, this work is by this artist, and give you a bit of provenance information. And it's something that has been already adopted by a few artists whose names you might know. Eric Fischel, David Sally, Micheline Thomas, and Chuck Close have all decided to start working with this technique and seeing it as kind of an alternative to certificates, that it's something that you can embed in the work and it will follow it anywhere. And the tag, I think, to put the synthetic DNA strand into the painting costs $150. And so that's one. Another one is blockchain technology, which is being used as a way to both authenticate and buy and sell and create sort of virtual scarcity for digital artworks. So the market for digital artworks is obviously something that is still very much emerging, but it's something that has struggled in part because the idea is that it would be infinitely reproducible online because it's virtual. But certainly, you know, photography and video, those are media where people have figured out a way to create artificial scarcity and then, you know, start to create a market for those. And so blockchain technology seeks to do the same thing for digital works of art. So the idea is that you can sell, buy, and create, become sort of a permanent part of the provenance of this work with one click of a button by transferring it on the Bitcoin blockchain, which is basically kind of like the internet in that it's a bunch of computers that are connected, and then once a transaction happens, unlike the internet, it's permanently a part of this chain. And so the idea is that it would be a secure way to buy and sell digital works of art. And there is one institution that so far has bought a work of art using Bitcoin on the blockchain. It's MAC Vienna, which is a contemporary art institution in Vienna. And in April, they bought a screensaver by a Dutch artist named Harn van den Dorpel. But that is the first and so far only instance of that happening on kind of an institutional level. As Joe mentioned, there are also some enterprising people who are trying to come in and fill in the gap from the connoisseurship side. So Richard Polsky, who is an art dealer and writer, launched his own one-man Warhol authentication committee startup this year, or last year in the fall. And he will authenticate or give an opinion on your work for $2,500 a pop. But as Joe also said, it is, you know, your opinion is only as good as the number of people who take stock in your opinion. So it is definitely to be seen how that will go. Another idea that has been floated around that was proposed at the NYU Art Law Day over the summer by Francis O'Connor, who is with the Pollock Foundation, is that experts could band together and create a kind of like consumer protection bureau for art. So you would get experts from, you know, you'd get dealers, you'd get auction house people, you would get scholars, and that somehow if it were an insured entity that was sort of across the art world, that they could give opinions with a bit more security. But again, that is still something that exists mostly in dreams at this point. And in terms of catalogs raisonné, I think another thing that is coming up that people are thinking about is a lot of artists, foundations, and estates are starting to put those online to make them easier to update and alter as new scholarship comes up and to make them a bit more nimble. So Noguchi, Cezanne, Morris Lewis are all artists and estates that have recently started to put their catalogs raisonné online. But I have heard some anxiety from artists' foundations that you know, sort of looking down the line and worrying, okay, at what point is rendering an opinion about a work in order to include or not include it in the catalog raisonné tantamount to giving an opinion on authenticity and therefore making them vulnerable to a lawsuit anyway. So I don't think it's something that we've seen yet, but it is something that people are, I think, a little bit worried about. I wanted to talk also about how contemporary artists are thinking about certificates. And it's, you know, as many contemporary artists as there are and as many different ways in which they work, that is the diversity of attitudes you're getting about certificates. And a lot of young artists are not thinking about them at all. I spoke with an art advisor recently who was looking at what she'd sold in the last 2 years, and she said 20% of those works came with a certificate. So that means that 80% did not. And I think it's particularly interesting to think about when you're thinking about contemporary artists, because it does give you a sense of sort of what matters most to them and what their biggest fears are. So somebody like Eric Fischel, who's had experience with forgeries and fakes, he, you know, obviously is looking to be at the forefront of the digital side, of the forensic side, because that's something that he's worried about. You also get artists who are reluctant to lock themselves in any way with a certificate or with a formal authentication process because they want to be able to change their minds. So Gerhard Richter, who's they're putting together his catalog raisonné right now, he recently decided he did not want to include anything that he made between 1962 and 1968. And so it leaves collectors with works from that period a little bit in limbo. There are also artists like Philippe Perrino, who recently filled this big hall over here over the summer, who, as a rule, does not use certificates, even though he creates additioned works, because he part of it is a way to distance himself from the market. And he has said before that he believes that the viewer authenticates the work, and so there is no need to give a certificate. You also have artists like Matthew Barney, who does not issue certificates for his photographs because the sort of way that they're produced, the paper on which they're produced, its forgery is not necessarily something he's so concerned about. But he does issue certificates for his sculptures, in part because they're additioned and he's found that it's the best way to keep track of those additions. He also issues certificates for his films, less to keep track, but because he found and his gallery found that it sort of put the market at ease, that this is something that could conceivably be infinitely reproduced, and so this is a way to say you have something that is a work of art that isn't an edition of 10. And I've also heard from some artists that it is sort of not issuing certificates is a way to make sure that they have control over their work. I spoke to an artist who went to her home of a collector who had hung a painting of hers above a radiator. And she said, if you don't move it, it's going to warp and it's going to melt. And the collector said, this is the only place that it works in my apartment. And she said, okay, but I'm not going to fix it if it gets ruined. And she told me in that case she was really happy not to have locked herself in with a certificate. Or sort of made things more complicated. But there are also artists who are thinking differently about it in terms of putting rules and sort of guidelines for how they want their work to be installed on the invoice rather than on the certificate, and that's something that dealers told me that they're seeing more with young artists. Gladstone Gallery had a show of wall drawings called Hello Walls over the summer, and it had about a dozen artists ranging in age and sort of level of establishment from Saul LeWitt and Lawrence Weiner, sort of, you know, titans of conceptual art, to artists like Wangechi Mutu and Ugo Rondinone, who are younger and sort of just starting to experiment with the form. And certainly a lot of the, you know, the estate of Saul LeWitt has this down to a science, and they, you know, these certificates are created, they give them off, they have the, you know, all the information that you would need about how to produce the work. While some of the younger artists preferred to include instructions on the invoice because it was something that could be instantly transferred, and also they felt sort of more comfortable with the idea that it would live on, you know, on the internet in a way that could be kind of constantly referred back to, as opposed to something that you'd have to go, you know, digging in a drawer or opening up a safe to find and consult. So that's also a shift that I think we're seeing at the moment.
Thank you to the three of you. That was a lot of information.